Today, we're going to look at a powerful and highly effective two-phase plan that destroys diabetes permanently. If you've recently been diagnosed with diabetes and you've just discovered this channel, let me recommend that you go to our uploads page, which will give you access to every diabetic video we've posted since we began. As you work your way through all our videos, I believe you'll find the help you need. A link to our uploads page is in the description. So, why a two-phased plan? And what exactly are those two phases? Well, I won't keep you in suspense. Phase one is the radical mode of eating you're going to need to get your blood sugar from outrageously high levels down into close to normal levels. This represents your initial battle plan of attack against the enemy who has caught you in his grip and is threatening your health, your life, and everything that you hold precious. If you've just returned from the doctor and you've been told you have really bad diabetic glucose levels, you need a plan, and you need more than just a few bottles of pills. You need a strategy that will eventually make those pills totally unnecessary. And what you need is phase one. But once you get your glucose down to acceptable levels, you're going to need a way to sustain that victory, not just for a few months, but for year after year and decade after decade, for as long as you live. And that involves the phase two plan, which is the maintenance phase. Phase one is drastic, radical, vicious, some might even call it fanatical. It involves going nuclear against the monster of diabetes, pulling out all those big guns and fighting like your life depended on it, which, in truth, it does. But phase two is how you eat and live once you get there, to your personal promised land of stable and normal blood sugar levels. It's sort of a kinder, gentler version of phase one. Now, this may remind you of one of the problems that some have with the Weight Watchers plan. Many people can lose weight on Weight Watchers, but once they get to their target weight, they ease up. After all, very few people could ever live the rest of their days counting points and living like they did in those early days of Weight Watchers. And often, those same people gain all the weight they lost, and they're in the same shape they were in before they started Weight Watchers. Well, let me tell you, this two-phased plan doesn't work like that. If you think you can just make a few changes for a few months and then go right back to how you were eating before, and diabetes will never make an appearance in your life again, you are badly mistaken. So phase two is not going back to where you were before you started. It is simply making a few adjustments and modifications which will give you more nutrition and make your meals and your life a little less severe and require a little bit less sacrifice. Now, some of you may be thinking, why not just stay on phase one all your life? Why not simply cut out all the carbohydrates once and for all and never eat them again? I don't have a lot of time to get into this, but I will share a couple of quick reasons why I don't think that's such a good idea. First is sustainability. If you make your diet totally severe and refuse to eat anything but meat ever again, it's pretty likely you'll eventually give up, just like the people who buy exercise equipment in January and sell it at a garage sale in July. By being as easy on yourself as possible, you make it a lot more likely that you can sustain your lifestyle year after year after year for the rest of your days. Second, when you give up all carbs, you tend to lose the ability to process carbs well. And if you ever do eat even a medium carb food, you may find your glucose will soar. Your pancreas and your metabolic system are like a muscle. If you never use them, never eat any carbs at all, they will tend to become less efficient. And if you ever do eat any carbs, you'll find your glucose levels are going to just get higher than ever. So, no, I've never advocating simply refusing to ever eat a single gram of carbohydrate. But today, that's not the problem for most of our world. We are eating way too many carbs. We are overdosing. We are drowning in an ocean of carbohydrates. And our poor pancreases cannot possibly keep up. For these reasons, a two-phase plan is best, with phase one being to radically reduce your carbohydrates, and phase two being to reintroduce certain healthy carbs, but with wisdom, with Mike, your blood sugar meter's permission. So let's look at phase one in crushing diabetes. You've just had your doctor tell you, you are diabetic. I'm not really talking about a diabetic who's just crossed over the line and maybe has an A1C of 6.7 or 6.8. I'm talking about men and women who find out their A1C is 8 or 9 or 10 or higher. If that's you, know that diabetes is destroying you every single day. Your organs, your glands, indeed pretty much all of your cells are under attack. Think of it as being mugged by a vicious criminal outside your house. He's beating you mercilessly, and blood is coming out from numerous wounds that he's inflicted. This is not the time to philosophize. This is no time to worry whether you're getting enough vitamin C in your diet. This is no time to wonder if perhaps you should enroll in a class on positive thinking. When you're fighting for your life, your one goal should be to get out of that fight any way you can. Get free from your attacker and then consider whether you need more vitamin C or whether you should enroll in the college course. Right now, there's just one thing to focus on. Either get away from or somehow overcome your attacker. And mild, moderate, polite little efforts will do you no good at all. You're going to have to get radical. And that is exactly how it is when you find out that your A1C is really high. It's time for radical action. And to help you see what I mean here, let me give you the definition of radical, or at least one of them. It means favoring extreme changes in existing views, habits, conditions, or institutions. In this case, what you're going to have to get radical with is your diet, the foods that you've been putting in your mouth at breakfast, lunch, and dinner for nearly all of your life. In phase one, you'll have to radically change your diet. And what you have to understand is that in the lives of most type 2 diabetics, a high-carb, high-sugar, high-bread, high-cereal, high-starch lifestyle have led to raging levels of insulin, which over years of time have made your cells and your whole body insulin-resistant. Just as when you take a drug or alcohol over and over again for years, you develop a tolerance for it, and it takes more and more of that drug or that alcohol to give you a high, so it is with you and carbohydrates. You've been eating such a monstrously high-carb diet for so many years and living with extremely high insulin levels as a result that your body, out of self-defense, has developed a toleration of insulin. Insulin no longer works nearly as effectively in moving sugar into your cells as it did when you were young. And the word we use for this condition is insulin resistance. The answer is to bring down those insulin levels in a big way, and the only way to do that is through a combination of very low-carb eating and time-restricted meals. You cannot eat cinnamon rolls and donuts and Little Debbie snacks, and you cannot spend all day long grazing on food, whether it's low-carb or high. You'll have to bring your eating under control. So, what exactly does this look like? Well, I don't like to be negative, but there is no way around it. There are a number of foods you should do away with altogether in this phase one plan of attack. Remember, carbohydrates raise blood sugar, and blood sugar provokes insulin release. The answer is pretty simple. Eliminate most carbs from your diet, and both glucose and insulin levels will drop. Not just a little, but they will drop big time. So let's talk about what you should avoid. In phase one, where you're making your initial attempt to get your blood sugar under control, you're going to have to cut out essentially all bread products. Not some bread products, but every last bagel, muffin, dinner roll, whole wheat bread, white bread, tortillas, hamburger buns, hot dog buns, and so forth. You will need to live a breadless life. Yes, I said it, a breadless life, for a while. But we're just getting started. You'll also need to cut out all other grains. Even the highly praised oatmeal will have to go. Say adios to all breakfast cereals, every form of pasta, all beans and rice, both brown and white, and even fruit will have to go, with the exception of small amounts of berries. And by all means, don't forget to cut out all sugar and all products that have significant added sugar. Now, you're saying, man, that's radical. Yep, sure is. But you're not being attacked by a scrawny 6-year-old little boy. You're being attacked by a hulk of a man, a monster, who wants to destroy you. And he is not going to be impressed with polite, modest, moderate little efforts. You may say, what can I eat? During this phase, you'll need to focus almost exclusively on the following foods. Non-breaded meat of all kinds, salads with low-carb vegetables with no croutons or chips in them, and no fruit except for a few berries. Nuts are okay, but not cashews. Cheese is good, and if you desire, you can eat keto types of bread products, such as a muffin made in a mug, which is made primarily with coconut and almond flour. And by all means, don't forget the eggs. Lots and lots of eggs. While you're going through phase one, you need to keep your goal in mind. You should determine as a goal that after this 3 months of phase one eating, you will go to the doctor, get an A1C test done, and you're going to see a major, not a minor, but a major improvement in that A1C score. And the thought of this upcoming A1C test and the look of shock on your doctor's face when he realizes what you've done should give you all the motivation you need to stay the course for these 3 months. Could you not do this and eat this way for 3 little months? Of course you can. Will it not be worth it to go from an A1C of 9 or 10 down to 6.3 or 5.8 or whatever it turns out to be? Will be so worth it. In phase one, you'll need to restrict not only what you eat, but when you eat. Gone are the days, yes, gone forever, when you started eating from the moment you woke up and kept right at it until a late night snack just before going to bed. That is over now. That person is dead. A new person with self-control and hope and enthusiasm for life has taken his or her place. Instead of eating throughout the day, most diabetics would be far better off creating a 6-hour window of time, eating their first meal of the day at 12 noon or 12:30, and having their second and last meal of the day at 6 or 6:30 p.m. Have some coffee with butter and cream as a substitute for your breakfast if you need to. And once that final 6 p.m. meal is over, close up the shop, turn out the lights, lock the door, and say goodbye to eating until the next day at 12 or 12:30 p.m. The only thing you will taste after your dinner will be your toothpaste later on that night. In phase one, most diabetics would do well to eat with a 6-hour window 6 days out of the week and to do OMAD, which is one meal a day, for that other day. This will go a long way in helping your liver and pancreas shed their fat and turn you into a lean, mean metabolic machine. There's almost no type 2 diabetic on earth that would not see significant improvement by employing this phase one plan for 3 months after living years on a standard diet of sugar and bread products. Not all may drop down into non-diabetic levels, but I would guess that most would in 3 short months. Now, where do you want to be with your A1C? That's a question only you can answer. Some people are satisfied with being just below the diabetic standard of 6.5, but for most it would be far better to get down into the fives. At one time, I was happy to be in the upper fives, but these days I've come to realize there's really no excuse for me not to be in the lower fives. Now, if after your 3 months of phase one, you're still not close to your target, you may need to repeat phase one for another 3 months, or even 3 months after that. Now, if you've gone 9 months eating like this and you're still not below diabetic levels, it's definitely time to get an insulin test and find out if your pancreas is producing enough insulin. If not, you may need to take insulin or other medications. Now, there's no shame in taking diabetic meds if you need them. And let me say that again because some of you really need to hear this. There is no shame in taking insulin or diabetic meds if you need them. But it is a terrible shame to not change your diet and see what you can accomplish. And from all the amazing testimonies I've heard since the beginning of this channel, it seems to me that most type 2 diabetics can get an A1C in the fives and eventually discontinue medication under their doctor's guidance. Okay, so let's say you've reached your A1C goal and you're ready for phase 2. Let me again emphasize what phase 2 is not. It's not simply going back to the way you used to eat. But it is carefully, wisely, and cautiously introducing foods into your diet that may work and that are worth investigating due to the nutrients they possess. You become a research scientist, researching yourself. You may want to research how beans affect you, for example. Beans have been eaten by people practically since people have been on the earth. Esau sold his birthright to his brother Jacob for a bowl of beans, probably lentils, which wasn't a very smart deal. I found that I can get by with eating a bowl of bean soup if it is 1, not a large bowl, and 2, made from beans which have a very high level of fiber. Now, how do I know this? Again, Mike the meter. You see, when you were in phase 1, you really didn't need Mike quite so much, except as a cheerleader and an encourager as he told you you were really improving, and also to make sure you weren't going too low. But in phase 2, as you experiment with some of what I would call the iffy foods, you really need our friend Mike. You need him to tell you what works for you and what definitely does not work. I've been in phase 2 for years now, but I still use Mike anytime I'm not certain about a particular meal or food. You may be able to eat occasional fruit, but again, you'll have to watch portion size. I can sometimes eat an entire apple with peanut butter on the slices for my lunch. But it's not a big apple, and that's usually about all I eat. Mike tells me this is okay as long as I don't eat it with some other rather high-carb foods. One way I sometimes boost my vitamin C is to eat clementines. They're much smaller than regular oranges and have only about 8 grams of carbs. And yet one clementine has a day worth of vitamin C. I can eat fried chicken, even though it has a breaded coating, as long as I don't add some other significant source of carbs. In phase 2, you can add a few foods here and there, testing yourself constantly to make your diet a bit more interesting and pleasant. There are some things I don't mess with, however, and 2 of them are potatoes and bananas. These foods are a total disaster to blood sugar, phase 1, 2, or any other phase. It's just not worth bothering with them. There are a lot of other ways to get nutrition besides eating potatoes and bananas. Rice is another food I just leave alone. Now, I'm telling you how I do it, but these are decisions you're going to have to make for yourself. You'll know you've truly won the battle once you spend some time in phase 2, and you're still getting A1Cs in the mid to low fives and fasting glucose numbers below 100 milligrams per deciliter. But even if my A1C stayed in the fives and my fasting glucose was reasonable, I would still never allow myself to eat any more than 50 to 70 grams of carbs per day. And that's because of the insulin factor. Even if you can somehow keep your glucose low, if your insulin is surging too high throughout every day, you're not doing yourself a favor. The somber truth is this. If you ever want good health and a long life, you will never be able to eat carbohydrates at the rate most of the world eats them, and you'll never be able to eat all day long from morning till evening. Whether in phase 1, phase 2, or any other phase you can dream of, relatively low-carb eating and time-restricted eating need to be a part of your life throughout the decade, your 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, or however long the Lord allows you to live. There are a few potential problems when entering phase 1 where you radically reduce your carbohydrates. First, if you're used to eating high carb and you're taking insulin or diabetic meds, you could easily end up with blood sugar dropping too low, too fast, and that can spell real danger. So talk to your doctor about this, and in those first days, check your blood sugar a lot. A second problem is that you may feel absolutely terrible when switching from a high-carb diet to a low-carb diet on a dime. Sometimes people call this the keto flu. It might be better to ease your way into phase one over the course of a couple of weeks than to go cold turkey. And thirdly, if you're used to extremely high blood sugar and then you cut your carbs way down, you may experience false hypos. This is where your blood sugar isn't bad at all, but you feel shaky, you feel like you may pass out. Yet when you check your blood sugar, it reads 88 or 95, which shouldn't make anybody feel bad. But when your body has gotten used to really high blood glucose and then it drops down into a normal range, you may feel like you're in bad shape. But this will typically pass quickly. As long as your blood glucose is in the 80s, you should be fine. But if you have any questions, talk to your doctor about it. Okay, that's it for now. Hope you found this helpful. If so, give it a thumbs up so YouTube will recognize its value and promote it to other diabetics who are desperately seeking answers. And consider subscribing and then clicking that bell icon so you'll be notified every time we post a new video. God bless. See you again soon.